high sexy to, I can I say, can I, okay. They literally range from hello sexy to I want to bend you over and jizz all over your back and God, it's awful. It was something that I, first of all, didn't know the impact that it was going to have. I also felt very uneasy at first at the thought of writing about it, because it was actually about sexually explicit images, videos, messages that I receive on my Instagram. And I thought to myself, this had been happening to me for quite a long time. Years, really. And I'd really noticed in the last couple of years especially, it was getting worse and worse. And this was really something that had started to kind of take its toll on me a little bit. So I thought, okay, why don't I write about this? So I did. And I think I did quite a few drafts of it at first. And I almost didn't even put it to Grazia, because the more I read it, the more I realized I'm actually about to kind of come out and admit something that's been going on that I've actually found very difficult to deal with. And I was kind of frightened of the impact that that might have. Part of me is really glad I did, but it was a mixed bag of being really pleasantly surprised at the reaction and also quite kind of alarmed at some reactions. But yeah, I would say overall, I'm glad I did do it. So I noticed that I'm very active on my Instagram. You know, I like to respond to as many people as possible, you know, fans that have questions about things. I'm a very approachable person. I'm friendly. You know, I like to connect with people. And I see that as my right to be able to do that on my Instagram. I just really noticed that these messages were getting really, really, really awful, to the point where I thought people were standing outside my house. You know, men saying that they had a telescope outside my house, they were peering into my living room, they knew what my cushions looked like and all that kind of stuff. And it started to get to the point where it made me feel unsafe. It's one of those things, I started to make jokes about it. And again, because, you know, we were in the middle of this pandemic, I was disguising it with humour as much as I could, like I do with a lot of things in my life that I find quite difficult, disguise it with humour. And you know, I was putting the posts up, the messages, and I was putting something funny and silly next to it to kind of take the edge off it, I think. I think that was a defense mechanism. The problem with that is now that people kind of think, I think people think I find it funny. So there's a kind of regret that I have there of kind of, you know, taking a humorous stance to it. To be honest, I think at first I did find it funny. There was an element where I was showing all my mates in the pub going, oh my God, you won't believe what this guy's just sent me. Oh my God, oh my God. And my friends would like squeal, you know. There was an element where I could just go, oh my God, that's awful, and put my phone down. But it was happening more and more and more and more. And it got to the point where it made me feel very isolated. It made me feel embarrassed. It made me feel like I was being targeted because of the girl that I was, the sort of girl that I am, you know. I felt like if I was a woman snuggling up to a husband, it wouldn't happen to me. There were points where I felt like that. Why me? Why am I the sort of girl that these people target? So I think that started to sit really uncomfortably with me, because I started to question who I was as a person. I started to question my work, my choice of kind of mannerisms I put out there. And it started to chip away at me. It started to completely, I started to second guess everything I was, everything I am. And you sit there and you go, Christ, is this real? Is this why I'm on my own? Is this why I'm single? Is this why, you know, men just kind of look at me in a certain light, in a certain way? Yeah, and that's when it really started to chip away at me, I think. Hundreds of messages a day. They literally range from high sexy to I don't want to upset anyone, but they literally range from hello sexy to I want to bend you over and jizz all over your back. And God, it's awful. One guy actually said to me, sorry, I'm getting a bit sweaty. One guy said to me, I want to fuck you with the telescope that I use to spy on you. And it's, yeah, the messages started to get like that. So I get hundreds of messages a day like that. I get videos of people masturbating to the point of ejaculation. I get photographs. It got to the point, I said this in a recent interview, it got to the point where I realised I was waking up in the morning, first thing we do, we check our phone, you know, and I was receiving on my Instagram DMs, I was seeing about 9 dicks a day before I'd even had my breakfast. It's not right, is it? The frustration I get is that when I tell people about this, the main thing is they go, well, just don't go on social media then, don't go on Instagram, don't go on your DMs, block the people. I do block the people, and then there's more that come in. That's not right, because that should be my private space. I think everybody's missing the point. They're missing the point. They're saying, blocking people and not using social media, I don't really see those as options. Why should that be an option? Why shouldn't I be able to enjoy social media like everybody else and use it to my advantage like everybody else does? And the men that are saying, oh, bore off, you get your tits out on Instagram, this is what you deserve, you know, you play all those kind of roles, you played Charlotte Hinchcliffe in The Inbetweeners, a girl with large breasts, you deserve this kind of attention. That is literally what loads of people say to me. I don't think I do deserve that attention. Social media is completely out of control. There is absolutely nothing to say that a dick pic is illegal. But if you go out into the street and somebody flashes you in the street, that's illegal. You'll probably get arrested for that. I know for a fact if I'm sat in the comfort of my own home and I'm scrolling through and I see 10 dick pics, penises I haven't asked to see, I know that there is something in me that I would never even think to call the police, because I know that nothing will be done. I know that there is nothing to be done about that. And that's not right, because we now spend most of our lives online. You know, our online life is just as important as our life crossing the street, you know. I can't believe that. And also this term dick pic is something that I really want to try and reclaim back as something that is an important thing. I think the term dick pic has now become quite comical, and it's kind of undermined the seriousness of what actually is going on here. I want to kind of reclaim this title dick pic and remind people that it's serious. It's not this, abbreviation that we can all just kind of laugh about and go, oh, I sent you a dick pic, here's a dick pic, dick pic. Dick pics are actually very damaging. They're psychologically very damaging if you have not asked to see one and you see 9 of them before you've had your cornflakes. I want to open my social media account and not have that sick feeling in my stomach knowing what I'm gonna see. I should be able to have my social media as a safe space, just like I should be able to walk out the door and walk to my local coffee shop and get a coffee without being flashed and without being sexually harassed. It's the same thing. We use our social media just as much as we use our local coffee shop. You know, we have that right to that privacy and to that safety. And if the internet and social media is as powerful as it is, it makes the world go round now. If it is that powerful, surely it has the power to make these changes and to fundamentally put these changes, implement these changes to make it a safer space for everybody. Do you know, the thing is, I say a million times over, I've got lovely men in my life. I'm so lucky to have the men that I have in my life. I've got brothers, uncles, dad, you know, and my friends. I'm one of the lucky ones in that I have so many wonderful men in my life that champion me and respect me. But it's not about them. It's not about the good men out there. It's not about, and I know that some men get very defensive and say, but it's not all of us. We're not. I know that. I absolutely know that. But if you're going to stand there and immediately undermine my truth, I'm sitting here saying this happens to me, right? My dad, if I say this to my dad, My dad doesn't sit there and go, yeah, but it's not all men, it's not all of us. My dad comforts me and says, that's awful, I'm so sorry, I'm here for you, and I'm an ally to you. That is what we're asking for. We're not sitting here saying, as women, all men are bastards, all men are flashers, all men are rapists. That's not what we're saying. We're saying that we need you more than ever now to be our allies and to stick up for us. Just stick up for us as women and acknowledge that there is a problem here. There's a problem with sexual harassment in so many different ways, but this particular problem, I think, is completely out of control. And I think it is your job as good men, if you are a good man, it is your job to be our allies and help us, stick up for us, and teach your sons, educate your sons. Because you can say a million times over that it's not all men, it's not all men. I know that. So prove that. Be a good man, and like you say you are, and stick up for us.